Hey folks, I'm Rob Grover, Trump Low County's Economic Development and Tourism Coordinator. And today we're doing a Discover Trump Low County short right here at the WTCO studio here in Whitehall, Wisconsin. And we have a very special guest with us, Kaya Fox from the La Crosse area, Habitat for Humanity. Kaya, thanks for being with us today.
Oh, thank you so much, Rob. I'm so happy to be here.
Yeah, well, we're super excited to have you. And the reason you're here today is because of an exciting project that is already starting to move forward in the city of Arcadia. But before we get into that, first of all, you know, just tell us a little bit about yourself. You know, how long have you been with Habitat for Humanity? What's the work you folks do? And how did you get into this sort of work?
Absolutely. So I've been with Habitat for Humanity as the executive director for 5.5 years now. But I have almost a 20-year history of working in affordable housing in the La Crosse area. So I have a really strong passion and a very strong belief that every single person in our community has a right to access decent, safe, and affordable housing. And I think being able to go to bed at night in a home that's safe and a home that's affordable makes a huge impact on the lives of the people in our community. And it also uplifts us as a community when we have people that live in decent, safe, and affordable housing. And so, you know, here at Habitat for Humanity, we really truly believe in the efforts that we do to make sure that the people in our community are under roofs that really provide for them and their families. So I really am proud and excited about the things that we do at Habitat for Humanity.
And you were telling me before we started today that you've, you know, been with Humanity for about 5 years, but you've been in the kind of the affordable housing realm for a long time. What kind of drew you to that? You know, that really, it's a tough area. It's a labor of love. There's a lot of challenges. What drew you to want to do that sort of work?
So I think a lot of times when we think about what are the, you know, the necessary things that people in a society need, we think a lot about, you know, food and economic stability, but a lot of times housing is one of the things that people miss as such an important and vital piece. So when we talk about, you know, like Maslow's hierarchy of needs, what do people need? You know, to have a roof over their head that protects them is one of those basic responsibilities we have to people in our society. And there's a lot of people all across the United States and within our community that don't have access to that. And the kind of the tidal wave of impacts when, you know, kids can't go home to a home that's safe, or families are stretched so thin because they're paying such a high amount of their monthly income on their housing, you know, that waterfall, that effect that happens on families as far as educational attainment for children, overall health of families, you know, the ability to build wealth and invest in their futures, and then the sacrifices people have to make in order to keep a roof over their head is something that I don't think we necessarily think about all the time. And so to be able to bring the importance of affordable housing to the forefront in a community has always been something that has been a passion of mine, and then being able to find really cool ways to make that possible is what I think Habitat for Humanity does best.
Oh, that's incredible. So, okay, so it's La Crosse area Habitat for Humanity. Kind of what is the geographic area that it sort of covers? Maybe it breaks down by county, that sort of thing.
So our Habitat for Humanity affiliate actually services 4 counties. So not only do we service La Crosse County in Wisconsin, but we also service Trumbull County, Vernon County, and then also Houston County in Minnesota.
Wow, okay.
So we have a pretty large service area, and in the time that Habitat's been in the community, which next year will celebrate 30 years.
Wow.
We have built 55 homes, and we have 4 homes currently under construction. And then once we add our Arcadia home, that'll be home number 5. So very, very excited to be partnering in this community.
Yeah, well, and that's a great way to seg in to why you're here today. Habitat for Humanity is building a home in Arcadia. Now, I didn't ask you this earlier. Is this the first home? How many homes in Trumbull County has Habitat for Humanity done? Or is this the first one?
This is our first one.
Oh, how wonderful.
Mm-hmm.
Very cool.
So Trumbull was the last county that was added to our service area. So
yep,
this will be our first home built in Trumbull County and obviously in Arcadia. So we're super excited compared to most of the houses that we're building to have, be able to make these connections
in
this community.
So, okay, how did you decide on, you know, lots of communities in Trumbull County, kind of how did you guys decide on Arcadia being a good candidate for one of these Habitat for Humanity homes?
And so obviously when we're looking at building homes for Habitat for Humanity, we kind of take a look at the communities and which communities have a really great need for affordable housing. And, you know, Arcadia, I think with you know, a lot of the different industry in the area. You have a lot of people commuting to work in those areas, and that's a drain on families when people spend a lot of time going to and from work. And so we approached the council and the city administrator in Arcadia and found out that, you know, one of their priorities was to develop housing in the community. And so, you know, what we do at Habitat and what the community was really looking for perfectly aligned.
That's wonderful. Okay, so now you're building a home in Arcadia. You're already doing some of the legwork with some different committees to kind of to make that happen. Let's talk just a little bit about that. Like, what are the different committees that are involved? And I assume members of the public, you would love it if they want to get involved in those.
Absolutely. So when we start building a house at Habitat for Humanity, it's not just Habitat that builds these houses. It's truly the community. And if people don't know a lot about how Habitat goes about building homes, we actually build them with volunteers. So our homes are primarily built by people within the community. Each Habitat home is about 175 individual volunteers and about 2,500 volunteer hours.
Wow.
And so it truly does take a community to build a home for a family. And so, you know, when we're starting in a new community, obviously we want to reach out and get as many people involved in that process as possible. So we've already actually started the formation of our first Arcadia House committee. And it is truly, honestly, all of the people in the community. Everybody has something to contribute. And so we're working with, you know, the school districts, we're working with elected officials, we're working with the library, we're working with just anybody and everybody who wants to be part of this. And we're kind of focusing on four different areas that we really need help with, especially in a new community. And the first one is, we really want to get people involved in helping us reach out to the community to find a family for this new home. And, you know, as a new organization coming into the community, you know, the support and the outreach and the connections that people within that community have will allow us to hopefully spread the word as far and wide as we possibly can, so anybody who is interested in being a Habitat homeowner has the opportunity to apply. We're also working in the community on recruiting the volunteers, you know, getting the folks that want to pick up the hammers and, you know, frame some walls and hang siding and put up windows and throw down flooring and hang cabinets. That entire process of a new home construction, you know, it's the people and, you know, the muscle strength that they have that makes that home happen. And so finding those folks in the community that want to join us in building the home. We also have a committee that is going to help us with fundraising. You know, obviously building Habitat homes are not free. There's a lot of costs and expense associated with it. And so how can we get the community together to do some fun fundraising events to get people fired up and supportive of the Habitat home and the family that's going to be moving in? And then the final thing is we have a construction committee. So we always at Habitat for Humanity want to use, you know, local suppliers, local subcontractors in the work that we do. And so being able to connect to the community and find those folks in the Arcadia and Trumbull County area that do the work so that we can make sure that the funds that we do spend stay local.
That's wonderful. I'm interested, you know, obviously there's been a lot of challenges for folks that are trying to build a home, just with construction costs and materials and that sort of thing. How has that national issue affected kind of the work of Habitat for Humanity? How have you kind of weathered that storm?
Oh, it's been a storm.
Yeah.
Definitely has been a storm. So when the pandemic hit, we actually had 5 houses under construction.
Oh, wow.
And we finished 3 of them. 2 of them are still under construction. You know, timelines were definitely set back. We did, you know, shutter our doors for a while to keep everybody safe. But even reopening, we found so many different challenges that we've been facing. And, you know, shortage in materials, cost of materials, the contractors in the area that we work with as subcontractors are busy. And so we've just seen more and more delays in the process that we have. And then, you know, the added, you know, work that we have to do in order to raise the funds to cover those cost differences that we're seeing. We're seeing upwards of sometimes 25 to 50% increases in material costs based on what we're looking for.
Yeah.
So it's been a challenge. It's been a challenge, but, you know, I think that's what nonprofits do is they find challenges and they rise to them and they find ways to work their ways around it. So we are ready to break ground on the Arcadia House this spring. So, you know, we will do it. We will build a house and we will find the ways to make it happen.
That's wonderful. And I guess that was going to be my next question. So then on the house in Arcadia, what is kind of your timeline? So I imagine a lot of the next cold months, if you will be spent, you know, planning and recruiting and raising money and that sort of thing. Then you'll break ground, you know, in the spring. And then what is your thoughts on how long the process will take to actually build the home? And then also, I assume there's already a site picked out in Arcadia. Can you tell us anything about that?
Yep, so it's on Wilson Street in Arcadia, so right across the cornfield from the school. So I think it's a perfect location. We have a lot that we were able to purchase from the city, so that partnership has already started from the very beginning. And the timeline is exactly as you said, Rob. You know, right now is that kind of gathering resources, getting everything together. We'll be starting very soon a family selection process to get the family in place. We'll be working with the architect we have at Habitat to design a home for that family. And then we'll be working within the community to pull together, you know, funds, excitement, volunteers, so that when the ground thaws this spring, we're ready to start building a house.
So let's talk a little bit about that family recruitment process. Now, if you, maybe people out watching this will know of a family that they think would be a great fit, or maybe a family watching this would be a good fit. I guess, what's the criteria? Who are you looking for? How does one even start the process to be considered? Because I'm sure there are probably many families that would love to benefit from this wonderful opportunity, but of course, you know, when houses are built one at a time, and not everyone that is deserving to be in one of these homes can get in there right away.
Absolutely.
So what is that process?
So we are going to be accepting applications for the Arcadia home starting October 15th. And applications will be due no later than 5 p.m. on November 19th. So we have a little over a 1 month window to get applications in. Our applications will be available on our website, which is habitatlacrosse.org. And all the materials and whatnot you need are downloadable. And you can start filling out that application. It's pretty self-explanatory. Habitat for Humanity is actually a lender. So we provide the loan to the family to purchase the house. And so it's an application as you would make out to a lender.
Yep.
So there's just a lot of information you gotta fill out. There's some additional information that we request as far as proof of income and, you know, your checking and savings account. And we ask all that information to come back by the 19th. Now, if people don't have their information all in by the 19th, they don't need to worry. Filling out homeownership applications can be kind of intimidating. There's a lot of paper, there's a lot of information, but we send out secondary notices if people don't have everything that we need, just giving them some extra time to get it in. So the point that we have is we want as many people to be able to apply for the program as possible. So, you know, we really help people and get them to the place that they need to be an applicant to the program. And so once the due date for applications is over, that's when we start reviewing all of the applications. And we look at three different things for Habitat homeowners. And the first one is, do they have the ability to pay for a mortgage? Mm-hmm. Habitat wants our homeowners to be successful. So we do look at things that a traditional lender would look at. You know, we look at credit score, we look at consistent income to afford a mortgage payment. With that being said though, Habitat for Humanity has a lot lower standards than you would with a lender. Mm-hmm. We're a little bit more forgiving, we're a little bit more understanding, especially for people in poverty. You know, there are hiccups and there are things that can happen, and we will help them. And so we take a look at those, that ability to pay. We also take a look at their willingness to partner. And this is another really cool thing about Habitat for Humanity is that our future homeowners actually have to put in sweat equity building their homes alongside our staff and our volunteers. So they get to, from the very beginning, pick up that hammer and help build that house that they're going to live in. And that sweat equity is something that we require from our homeowners, 350 to 400 hours.
Yep.
And so their willingness to participate in that volunteer reciprocation is one of the things that we look for in our applicants. And then the final thing we look for, which is really unique to Habitat as well, is that need. We want to serve the families who have the greatest need. So we actually come to the homes and we do home visits to just see what are the barriers to safe and affordable housing that our families are experiencing. And then based on those three criteria, we pick the one that has that kind of meets all three of those criteria the best. And so that at the end of the day, we're picking the families who are most ready to be homeowners, who are most willing to be homeowners, and then who have the greatest need to be homeowners. And I think one of the things that people worry about is what you alluded to. There's always more people that need affordable housing than we have the ability to work with. But Habitat builds houses every year. And one of the things that we do is when a family is denied, so they maybe weren't selected this time around, we actually give them the resources and we link them to different programs that we have at Habitat for Humanity to get people ready to be a homeowner. So if you didn't quite make it this time, we're gonna tell you what didn't work, and here are a bunch of resources. So even if you aren't sure that if you apply that you're gonna be selected, the information that you get from that failed application is gonna give you the things that you need to be successful in the future. And so the time that you spend filling out an application isn't in vain, because you're gonna get all these wonderful things from Habitat that you can start preparing yourself for home ownership. And so the vast majority of people who apply to Habitat aren't successful on their first time. It's future applications that they make that allow them to get into the program. And so we really do believe in getting people prepared for home ownership and giving them the best resources and chances possible to be successful.
You know, that's a really great point, because I think a lot of us know about Habitat for Humanity and we know, well, they build houses. But I think a lot of people wouldn't be aware of all that other work that you do with folks to help them, like you said, get prepared, learn what they need to do to be able to get into a home. That's really fascinating.
And I think that's part of the whole mission. You know, it's our mission is to provide people with decent and safe and affordable housing. And it doesn't just end at the homes we build. You know, it's advocating for housing and it's supporting people who want to be homeowners find that path. And so, you know, it might not even be that they qualify for a Habitat home. They might qualify for another home, but we're excited regardless of how they get there.
Yeah, no, that's really interesting. So this is you know, a little broader, but what, in your opinion, you know, working in this area for so long and doing the work I do, economic development work, you know, housing is one of the biggest issues people are facing. Rents are more expensive than ever. It's tougher than, you know, wages aren't going up. I mean, but in your opinion, what are those biggest barriers that are keeping folks out of homes? And making it inaccessible for a lot of people. A lot of people that have traditionally good paying jobs, right? That sort of thing. They're still struggling to find housing, afford housing, especially, you know, starter homes, that sort of thing. I mean, what are those barriers that are keeping people from being housed in their own home?
That's a beautiful question. Habitat for Humanity was started in 1992 with a group of grassroots citizens that seriously picked up some signs and they marched in protest against housing prices and how unaffordable housing was. And I think back to those folks from 30 years ago and I think, you know, what would they say today to see that we've actually, you know, backtracked on our progress to affordable housing. Because what we see in the statistics and the numbers out there is that the cost of housing continues to rise year after year after year. It is a beautiful investment because over time it becomes worth quite a bit more money than what you hopefully paid for it at the beginning.
Yeah.
But what that does is our wages haven't kept up with that. And so the amount of money people are taking home, you know, at the end of the day is not at pace with the cost of housing. And so what it does is year after year is it pushes more and more people out of the housing market, the ability to afford a house payment. And so being able to have an agency like Habitat and other affordable housing agencies that are addressing that is pivotal to communities, because homeownership is vital, not only to families as an ability to build wealth and see growth, which is something that we all want and we all need in order to, you know, succeed, but it's also vitally important to communities. You know, as somebody who maybe owns a home in a community, you want to see the people around you investing in your community, purchasing properties, putting down roots, you know, not only just for the economic impacts that it has. You know, you've got people paying taxes, they're maintaining their properties, they're staying in employment in your area, but it also creates this sense of community. You know, people who are invested in your community, who, you know, participate in the different activities, and they join events and mm-hmm. boards, and they become, you know, very productive citizens.
Yeah.
And so when we start seeing communities in which homeownership starts declining over time, we see a lot of other declining areas that you didn't even realize were a part of that investment in ownership of homes in a community.
So what do you think, you know, we as citizens, you know, if we're concerned about this issue, and we all should be, what can we do politically? What can we do to help, one, get the word out, and not just about this project, but just the bigger issue of home affordability, you know, maybe to our legislators or in our communities? I think people always want to know, what's an action I can take? How can I make things better? Obviously, this project being a piece of that, mm-hmm. number one way. And then in a bigger sense, like what can we do to try to make this better for folks?
I think a lot of people focus more on federal legislation when it comes to housing. So, you know, we see the talking heads on our TV and we go, oh, there's nothing I can do mm-hmm. because this is a big issue at the federal level. And it doesn't seem like sometimes people can come together. But the real changes and the real things that happen that affect housing in your community happens at a local level. Mm-hmm. You know, so it is the different ordinances and the different investments and the different emphasis that communities put on affordable housing in their communities. And so, you know, making sure that you're talking to your local elected officials and letting them know that affordable housing or the development of housing in general is something that's really, you feel is very important. You know, and attending meetings in which decisions on local housing laws, rules, ordinances are happening, and speaking up and showing your support is vitally important to what is happening day to day in your community and how people in your community have access to those resources and, you know, what your community is going to look like in the future.
That's great. Okay, so we'll circle back to it. The applications open on October 15th. Mm-hmm. That's for families. Remind us of the ways people can get more information, get the application in, or reach out to you or other staff if they have questions.
Oh, absolutely. So our applications are going to be on our website, which is habitatlacrosse.org. You can actually email us as well, and that email is info@habitatlacrosse.org. And then we'll actually be hosting some informational sessions about the homeownership program on October 28th and 30th. You can go to our website for more information on the times and to register, but it's going to be at the Ashley Furniture Conference Room. So I'll be on hand. We'll be walking through the application process. You can pick up a copy of the application, and then you can also ask any questions that you have about the programs. We'll also be having copies of the application available at the Arcadia Library, so folks can also stop there and pick them up.
Wonderful. And I just want to remind people again, there's four committees you're looking to recruit for: the committee to help select the family, a committee to help recruit volunteers, fundraising committee to pay for it, and then the construction committee that helps plan all that. So there's looking at those different areas, there's really something anyone could be part
Absolutely.
Of that they could get involved with.
Absolutely. So. And, you know, we've done this in a lot of communities that we've worked with, and it has been one of the most rewarding experiences I've ever had. The ability of communities and people to come together to go from a flat piece of land to a home that a family will be raising their children in and having meals and opening Christmas presents is one of the most touching and amazing things that somebody can be a part of.
Oh, I bet. So then at the end of one of these projects, I mean, you spoke to it a little bit, you know, do we have a big celebration?
Oh,
sometime,
absolutely.
You know, God willing, late next year, are we going to be celebrating, having a party of some sort? Or
absolutely. So we want to have this house done before the end of 2022.
Yeah.
And we always do a home dedication. And that home dedication, anybody and everybody can stop on by. We have food. We do tours of the house. And it's a way for us as Habitat and the family to just say thank you to everybody that helped make it possible.
That's wonderful.
And, you know, the beautiful thing about those dedications is there's physical walls that you get to touch,
yeah.
That, you know, people in your community, you know, blood, sweat, and tears went into putting that together.
And I would think too, once, you know, because this is the first one in Trempealeau County, you know, once you've done one here and you've built a group of volunteers, it gets a little bit easier to continue to do it in the community. And I think that's something for people to remember as well. You know, once we've established sort of this infrastructure, people that have done it, you know, to inspire maybe spots in other areas of Trempealeau County, maybe it's a little more possible, a little more attainable. So this could really build on, you know, future endeavors in the county with Habitat for Humanity.
You're absolutely right, Rob. This is the first of many homes.
That's wonderful. Well, anything we missed? Anything you want to leave us with? Anything like that? It's such an incredible project. I don't want to forget anything.
I just want to encourage people in the community. You know, whether you're thinking of applying to the program, you know, whether you want to get involved, you know, long term, short term, you know, by all means, go to our website, send us an email. We'll find a place to put you, and you know, to be a part of that is just going to be a really rewarding experience, I can guarantee it.
Well, that's really awesome. Well, again, Kaya Fox, La Crosse area, Habitat for Humanity. What a pleasure to have you here at the WTCO studio today. Again, my name's Rob Grover. If you want any more information on this incredible project that we're doing here in Trempealeau County, or the Habitat for Humanity is doing, that information will be I'm sure, streamed a number of times through the show here. So again, thanks again for watching this Discover Trempealeau County Short, and we'll talk to you soon.